Hello and welcome to the Thinking Bee podcast. My name is Stuart Ratcliffe. I'm a beekeeper in southern Indiana. This is a beekeeping and agricultural centered podcast, and I have a Thinking Bee podcast group page on Facebook, so make sure you join and receive the updates I post there. So sometimes I will ask for questions to ask the guests that I have. And I also plan on hosting a Q&A pretty soon, so I'll be looking for questions to address there. In this episode, I talk with Michael Bush, a beekeeper in Nebraska. He is a proponent of treatment-free and small-cell beekeeping, and he has a website at bushfarms.com, and he is also the author of The Practical Beekeeper. We talk about the information on his website, small-cell bees, and the future of beekeeping. Michael is very active in contributing to online beekeeping forums, speaking around the country, and is just a wealth of knowledge and beekeeping experience that he's willing to share with everybody. So here's my talk with Michael Bush. Thanks for doing this. I know you're a busy guy, so I understand you right. You're doing some speaking engagements often.
It's been often for years now, but yeah.
Yeah. Is there a certain time of the season that you're, you know, mostly working with your own bees instead of out speaking?
Well, it's taken me a while to get that to work out the way I wanted. I originally had it twice as expensive during bee season for me to speak. And then when that didn't work, I made it three times as expensive. And I finally got it where people will schedule my speaking engagements out of bee season. So.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. That's why I was assuming that winter was probably your most busy time as far as speaking goes.
Yes.
So you're getting ready to head to Alaska, I think?
Yeah, tomorrow.
Okay. And I kind of looked up some of the details on that, and it's like a treatment-free symposium. I think it's the second one. So were you there at the last one?
No. This will be the first time I've ever been to Alaska, so.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it was, I thought it was interesting. It's kind of, you know, such a specific event for Alaska. You know, I'm not sure, exactly how many beekeepers there are in Alaska, but I guess there's enough interest to hold something specifically to treatment-free beekeeping. Yeah, I was looking, I think last year you had stuff about your bee camp. Was last year the first time you hosted something like that at your own apiary?
I'm trying to remember. Was last year the first year or was last year the second year? I don't remember. One or the other.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'd have to go look again. It might have been my first year. I get too busy.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, I thought it sounded really fascinating, a really good opportunity for people to come and do something like that hands-on. And yeah, I was just kind of wondering how that went the first or second time that you've done that.
I think it went really well. Everybody who came sure seemed to think it was wonderful. Yeah. I think there's just such a difference between talking about things in a book or talking about them on a forum or even speaking about them live and actually looking in a hive and saying, this is what I see and this is why I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Because an awful lot of beekeeping is more of an art than a science. A lot of it is you look at it and you go, this is what I think is going on and this is what I think needs to be done. And,
yeah.
There's just nothing quite like looking in the hive and seeing that rather than talking about it.
Yeah, I think people you tend to like step-by-step instructions, and beekeeping is not really like that. You know, it's
not really.
A lot of it's intuition, and every season is different. And so, you know, going by what someone is telling you over the internet, you know, you may actually do something different if you were actually there looking at the hive. But, yeah, I definitely think that if people, you know, are actually going to a beekeeper that has, you know, many, many hives and are able to go through, you know, a lot of them, they get kind of a feel for what, you know, what is normal for a colony to be looking like at that time of year. And so that's especially beneficial to people. So yeah, I think that's probably a good opportunity for people to come and do that with you.
Well, not only what's normal, though, but what the range of that normal is. This colony looks like it's getting ready to swarm, and this colony looks like it's kind of languishing right now. And why is that? Did they already swarm, or is the queen not doing very well, or, you know. So, you know, not every hive's in the same state for different, and sometimes they're in the state they're in for different reasons.
Yeah, so. Yeah, and, you know, some may be more ahead or more behind than others, and that may, you know, benefit them later on.
Yeah, and some of that is decisions that the bees make, because the bees are gambling. They have to raise enough bees before the flow to take advantage of the flow, and if they time that well, then they'll do really well. And if they time that poorly, they'll do really poorly. And nobody knows for sure when the main flow is going to hit, but as a beekeeper, you should have a feel for when it usually hits, and maybe you can help them out to try and make that population peak at the right time to help those bees out. But in the end, they make their own decisions, and if they make those decisions and they don't pan out, either because they're bad decisions or because that season's just different, you know, that season the flow was 2 weeks late, or it was 2 weeks early, or whatever, that has a lot to do with how well that colony does. And they all make different decisions. You know, it's like having kids. They decide to do what they want to do, and they do it.
Yeah.
You can't always change that. You can try. You can try to influence that, but there's no guarantees you can change that.
Yeah, well, that may be, you know, how they've been able to survive this long. And you sent that to me in an email a while back about bees being gamblers and kind of, you know, not necessarily just looking at your apparently big producing colonies with a lot of bees, you know, it may be the smaller ones that actually, or the, I guess what we would say average, ones that may, turn out to be the, you know, actually the biggest producers in the long run, you know, and, you know, there's been studies about how, you know, most swarms, you know, actually don't survive their first winter due to starvation. You know, I think I saw one study that showed, you know, only 20% of swarms would survive their first winter, you know, so they're gambling in their swarming activity too. I think, you know, some that, you know, if they swarm too late, they're not going to be able to build up for winter. If they swarm too early, they may build up too much and swarm again, and then again not build up enough for winter. So I guess the goal maybe is to look at what the colony is doing over a long period of time and kind of gauge from that as to what a good colony is. Yeah, well, I just want to say I really like your website. You know, to people that don't know, you know, it's, I'll put the link up in the info, but it's just basically a wealth of information and almost a encyclopedia-like format. But I think one of my favorite sections on your website is bee math. And, you know, it's something I find myself just referring back to, you know, all the time. You know, I'm starting to kind of remember things in my head, but just knowing bee math, I think something as simple as that can really help out beginner beekeepers, you know, and knowing when their queens should be laying or how long it's going to be before all this potential brood is hatching out. Do you find that that's something that you kind of have to refer back to, or do you pretty much have it all memorized by now, I'm assuming?
I pretty much all have it all in my head. Yeah. I wrote the page mostly because when I first started beekeeping, all the books would talk about the numbers. They talk about, you know, it's this many days till egg hatches, and this many days till it gets capped, and this many days till it emerges, and this many days till the drone's out in the congregation area, you know, flying, and, you know, all those kinds of numbers, but they never said what they meant. You know, what are they good for?
Yeah.
And I felt like it took me years of beekeeping before it finally soaked into me what they meant. And I thought they could have done a better job of presenting them from a point of view of, you know, what, if if the hive gets queenless today, how long before I see eggs? And how long before it's just going to be too late and they're, you know, this queen isn't going to pan out. Either she's never going to be here or she's going to be a drone layer. How long are, you know, till, if they swarmed yesterday, how long till, you know, if that was a primary swarm, how long till the next queen comes out? Things like that. But they didn't really say it that way. But in the end, you finally learned to start calculating those things.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, amazing that knowing simple facts about bee biology, it can really benefit you a lot. You know, I think a lot of beginners, you know, when they think that they have queen issues, you know, they're either not waiting long enough to see whether a queen is laying again, whether the hive requeen themselves, or whether they, you know, put a queen cell or virgin queen in, or, you know, sometimes they wait too long and then you have a lot of problems then. Whereas if you did know bee math, you know, you could really, you could accurately make a judgment. You know, I've been raising queens the last few years. So, you know, knowing when a drone is, going to be heading out to a drone congregation area, you know, by going off of the stage of brood it's in, or by, you know, what the drone larva and drone pupa in the cell looks like, I can kind of gauge on when I can start grafting. And so that's a very important part too, I think.
You touched on the queenless issues. One of the ones that always baffles me is how many people on the forums in October are convinced they don't have a queen.
Oh, yeah.
When the queen just shut down.
Oh, yes.
They're just absolutely sure they don't have a queen because they haven't seen her. Well, just because you can't find her doesn't mean she's not there. They're assuming, oh, well, she's not there because I don't have any eggs, I don't have any brood, I must be queenless. But maybe you are, but it's in October, I would expect her to shut down, so I don't know why, you know, but I apparently, the other thing the books don't seem to cover very well is that they talk about a colony. They might talk about it from the point of view of you install a package and it goes through these stages to become hive, but they don't talk about it from the point of view of what a colony is doing in the spring and what it's doing in the summer and what it's doing in the fall and what it's doing in the winter. It seems like there's a lot of that that's lacking in the typical bee books I read. And so the beekeeper is shocked that their queen isn't laying in October, so they think they're queenless.
Yeah, yeah. And that definitely depends on your location. You know, things, you know, we have a dearth, you know, from the middle of July through August. And so, you know, queens kind of tend to not shut down all the way, but, you know, knowing when what your a general seasonal cycle looks like, you know, when you can expect that is, you know, location is something to consider, I think.
And race of bees, but even just the difference between one colony and another colony. I have colonies that sometimes will completely shut down in a dearth in July. Yeah. But that's may not be the norm, but it happens. If I jump to the conclusion they're queenless, I could very well waste a lot of money buying queens.
Yeah. Do you attribute that to a certain strain or maybe a lineage of bees?
Well, the feral ones, as a general rule, tend to be a lot more frugal. They tend to shut down in a dearth. They tend to actually keep some drones all winter, which I hardly ever see any of the domestic ones do. Yeah. They don't keep a lot of drones. They just keep a few drones, but you'll see a few drones in there. They keep a lot smaller clusters in the winter, and they survive with a cluster the size I would expect them to die if it was Italians, and they'll survive. So they make different decisions, and it's probably the ones that attribute to them surviving in my climate, you know, because we could have a dearth that might run from July till August. It might even run from July all the way into winter. Mm-hmm. Or we might not. We might not have a dearth at all. It might actually keep raining enough that things bloom all the way through. it's kind of unpredictable. So maybe the bees that are smart enough to adapt to what's happening this year are the ones that are more likely to make it through the winter.
That's really interesting. One more thing about your website I kind of want to talk about is you kind of have done this compilation, I'm assuming, of Huber's new observations. Did you compile a kind of a new book or add things to an existing translation?
Well, the sequence went more like this. When I first started beekeeping, everybody talked about Huber and his book, and I could never find one. And so after decades of looking, when the internet finally came along, I finally did find one, and I found an 1821 English translation and an 1809 English translation, but both of them were only volume one. And so I worked so hard to find it, and I thought there were a lot of people out there who could benefit from it. So I typed it all in, put it on my website. One of the nice things about having it all typed in and on your website is it's easy to search. It's easy to find what, you know, you're trying to remember something you read in there. You know, if it's typed in, you can find it. If it's scanned and it's just a picture, you can't hardly find it. And the OCR is usually so poor that you can't hardly find it. And actually, the 1809 version also has Fs for all the S's, so it's almost unreadable. I mean, even if you had the original in front of you, it's almost unreadable. So I was trying to make it more readable. And I, all along, I was looking for C.P. Dayton's translation, which I knew he had done in the 1920s, but I just wasn't having any luck finding it. So finally I found the C.P. Dayton version in about, it must have been about 2010 or 2011, I finally found it, and I bought one. And then it's the same dilemma again. If I had this much trouble finding it, other people are having a hard time finding it. So I transcribed it, typed it all in. Not only that, the font on it was so small that I could barely read it. So it was really difficult to type in, but I typed the whole book in. And then I went to do the plates. He had actually had photographs of all the plates, but they were terrible photographs. They were probably yellowed plates and not very good. So the wonderful thing about the internet, especially now that it's really blossomed, I actually found an original 1814 French version with the original plates in it. This is when volume two was first published, along with volume one. In other words, when all of those plates were actually in one book for the first time, was 1814 in French. And I found an original 1814 French edition, and the plates were in great shape. So I scanned them all in. They're still old, you know, old paper. And so I cleaned them all up, and then I split all of the individual figures out and tried to put them in the text where they occur. So when Huber's talking about volume one, plate two, figure three, his description is on the opposing page to that picture of that figure. So you're not flipping through the book trying to find the plates at the back, find the right figure to see what it is he's talking about. And that's especially helpful in the section where he's talking about the structure of the comb, because there's so many three-dimensional things he's trying to get across of, this is what it looks like from this side, and this is what it looks like from this side, and this is what, you know, how the bottom's shaped, and this is, if you did a cross-section from the side, it would look like this. And so he's got all these descriptions of the plates. And so I put all the plates, all the figures in the text where they occur, and then try to do one that looks like the whole plate with all of those figures together, so you kind of see their relationship to each other. And so I spent thousands of hours just cleaning up the plates and then typing in the whole book and then trying to get it all arranged where it was readable. So it was a huge investment of time, but I think it's an extremely important book. I think what he discovered is being not really paid attention to even today.
Yeah, so Do you care to go into some detail about that?
Well, for instance, all his detail on how they build comb, you know.
Okay.
Most of what you'll read in books today, they speculate a little bit. He didn't speculate. He would figure out a way to observe it. I know he's blind. That sounds ridiculous, but as he used to say when somebody questioned him on that, how can you be so certain of your observations? And he says, I'm far more certain of my observations than you are. You have only your eyes to trust, and I have the consensus of two or three witnesses.
That's pretty clever.
Yeah. So he came up with ways to actually see them build the comb. The first set of experiments he did was he tricked them into building the comb up, which you can do if you play the game right, and that way the bees wouldn't be clustered around it, so he could see every detail of what they did. So after he did that, he documented that. He's got a whole chapter or two of documenting that. Then he said, okay, but now there's the possibility that they might do it differently when they build it down. So I still have to figure out a way to trick them into letting me see what they do when they build it down, so I can compare it to what they did when they build it up, just to make sure that I'm not lying about what they do when they build comb down, which is how they usually build them. So then he goes through a whole bunch of experiments to do that and explains all that in great detail. Well, the details are stuff that I don't see anywhere, but it's obviously true if you kept bees and watched what happened and compared different things. For instance, you know, how do they build comb? Well, they excrete on their abdomen these little flakes of wax or wax-like substance that they make the wax out of. Mm-hmm. He tested it, compared it to testing beeswax, and he says it's not beeswax. That stuff they secrete on their belly is what they make beeswax out of, but it's not really beeswax because you can, it doesn't dissolve the same. It doesn't dissolve in the same chemicals. It doesn't, it's obviously, you know, the precursor to beeswax, but okay. It's not beeswax. Then they mix that with something from their saliva and they work it. They turn it into this kind of a putty. And they sculpt it. They shape it into this, you know, and into comb. And they do it. Each bee just does one little tiny bit of that and then wanders off. You know, this one bee takes this piece of wax and chews it a little bit and sticks it to this blob up there where they're starting to work. And then it wanders off. And then another bee goes over and sticks another one on and sculpts it a little bit. And then they wander off. And another one goes up and sticks another piece on and gets a little more serious about sculpting it because there's a little more there to sculpt.
Yeah.
And then she wanders off, and they just keep doing that. Mm. And then there's actually bees like on both sides working against each other. So like when they get to the bottom of the cell, there's a bee on the inside of three cells on the other side to work against the one that's on the one inside the cell, working on the one bottom of this one. And they're actually like working opposite each other.
Yeah.
Thinning out the comb. So that if the one on the other side wasn't there, the one on the one side would break through if the one on the other side wasn't there working against it.
Oh, wow.
So they're thinning it down to where it's just so paper thin you can see through it.
Yeah.
And it started out, it was kind of this putty stuff. Now they've thinned it down to where it's, you know, almost transparent. And now that they've, you know, now they move on, they keep moving down and building more cells, and they keep building more of this. Now they build this comb. And if they're in a big hurry, then they fill it all full of nectar and they cap it, and it's still all white and soft and it's like putty. And people who raise comb honey, that's what they want. And if you can trick the bees into building it fast enough, that's what you get. But if you can't trick them into it fast enough, then after they get done making the comb, then they come back with some propolis and they reinforce every vertice, every angle where an angle meets another angle, every little corner in there. They stretch out propolis and make a little string and put it in that corner and work it into the wax to reinforce it.
Hmm.
And then when they get done with that, they come back and they secrete something from their mouth that they paint the whole thing with that turns it a little more yellow and makes it from that white, soft, putty-like substance into something that's tougher, that we tend to call mature wax or older wax, but it's not really the age of the wax that makes it tougher. It's whatever they paint it with that changes that putty-like substance into that tougher wax that we're used to seeing. Then they come back and they tear down all the foundations where it's attached to the top in the first place, and they do it a little at a time, and they keep mixing that with propolis and reinforcing that with propolis. So it's like half propolis and half wax up at the top when they get done. And actually, it's interesting because it resolved a lot of the arguments at the time. There were people who said that they just made it out of wax and they never came back and mixed propolis with it. And there were people who believed they mixed propolis with it in the first place because they could see that it had propolis mixed with it. But he actually observed that they built it without doing that, and then they came back and did it afterwards.
Oh. So,
and anyway, that's the kind of stuff that I don't I don't see anybody in books even talking about. If they do talk about like it being tougher and kind of yellow, they'll call it travel stain.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was, I guess. Yeah.
Well, that's what the books say. All the books today will say that. They'll say that it's just the bees walking on it turns it yellow. Well, no, not really.
Yeah.
Sometimes you'll see a cell where the left half of the cell is painted with that yellow and the right half isn't, because they got interrupted when they were in the middle of it.
So
some of those things kind of convince you that Huber's probably right and all the rest of this is speculation.
Wow. Yeah, that's pretty incredible that him, you know, having the help of maybe a couple of other people, him being blind, you know, being able to have that kind of observation in a way that people don't really have today. His observations, were they mostly, details about the comb and maybe about the bees themselves? Did he really try to observe any like certain bee behaviors besides that, or
all kinds of stuff? But yeah. When he wrote volume one, before he got to volume two, most of the big controversies in among naturalists about bees were things like whether or not the queen mated, what purpose the drone served. They were even arguing over whether the queen was female, whether she actually laid eggs, whether what she laid were actually eggs, whether she just needed to have drones somewhere around, or whether she actually had to mate with them, or whether she mated with them in the hive, or what. He was the guy who discovered that they mated outside the hive, the drone died in the process, he was the one who discovered all of what we pretty much know about bees now. The formation of swarms, they've been arguing for years whether the old queen left or the new queen left. And of course, part of the reason for the confusion is the first swarm, the old queen leaves, and the subsequent swarms have virgins with them. So he's the one who, pretty much proved all this stuff, pretty much every useful thing we know about bees.
Yeah.
Things about the formation of swarms, differentiating. Another one of the arguments at the time was whether or not a queen egg was a special egg that only could make a queen, and that the queen had to lay it in a queen cell. That was one of the views that they build a queen cell, the queen lays in it, and it develops into a queen. And you had some fairly reputable naturalists who would take that view, and some other fairly reputable naturalists who said, no, I can just take a hive, make it queenless, and they will turn a worker egg into a queen. And they'll just build the cell out from the worker's cell. So they were arguing as if it was always one or the other. The one side believed that they always built it from a worker cell, and the other side believed they always built a special queen cell and the queen laid in it. The reality is they do both. And he finally proved that, and under what circumstances they would do which.
Mm-hmm.
If you make them queenless, yes, they'll build a bunch of emergency cells, and those will just be built out from a existing worker. And if you get them crowded and get them swarmed, then they'll build a queen cell, the queen will lay in it, go down that path.
Yeah.
But all this stuff was still speculation at the time. Nobody could pin it down. And they hadn't really made up their mind on that. The whole drone thing, one of the theories was that maybe the drones just emanated something, because nobody had ever seen a queen mate with a drone in a hive. So they assumed maybe she never mated with the drones.
Was this
pretty groundbreaking stuff when he wrote it, and a lot of it we just assume now, but then a lot of it we just blew off and didn't pay attention to.
Yeah, was this before the, I guess, movable frame hive, or after?
Well, he invented the movable frame hive.
Okay.
There was no movable frame hive before. He built a leaf hive.
Yeah.
Which was a bunch of frames that were hinged, and you hinge them open to get to the combs.
So I'm assuming that maybe he was using that in order to further his observations, or did he
where he started was he built these observation hives that were just one pane thick. They were one frame thick, and they had a glass pane on both sides so you could watch everything that happened. And so he went through all his experiments doing that. And then when he got to the end, some people had some objections and said, well, yeah, but what would they do if there were parallel combs? So then he built the leaf hive, which had parallel combs, but he could open it up and put a glass sheet in to watch what was going on anytime he wanted to, and then put it back to being parallel combs when it was done. And so he repeated all of his experiments again in the leaf hive. So he did both.
Okay.
Before he was done. But that's kind of why he invented the leaf hive, was so he could have parallel combs and still open it up and,
yeah,
you know, put the glass in and watch what was going on.
Yeah, I need to get that book and go through that. I've been meaning to go back and read some of the old beekeepers' writings, and probably something that people don't do enough of today. Well, yeah, so I was kind of moving on, just for people, some people that don't know, you're kind of a proponent of, you know, using small cell or natural cell bees or combs. And so I guess for people that don't know, you know, having a smaller cell that the bees build is supposed to, I guess, shorten the development time of the bees, and that therefore kind of prevents varroa from producing as much offspring. So I've kind of confused a little bit about if, so is it the actual cell size that is shortening the bee development time, or can that also be done by, I guess, the bee's genetics alone, or is it kind of a combination of both?
I think it's entirely cell size. It's just, but genetics may have something to do with what size cell they build. So if you look at Africanized honeybees, they typically build cells somewhere between 4.4 and maybe 4.9, they say. But actually, that's about what I see any wild bees build if you let them get back to normal size. So, but the observations on the Africanized bees is that they have a gestation time from egg to emergence of about 18 days, maybe 19 days at the most.
Okay.
But that's the same as the observations of natural comb of European honeybees by Huber and by Zerzon. And Zerzon was almost as much of a breakthrough as Huber. It's between Huber and Zerzon, pretty much they cover everything, because Zerzon was the guy who proved parthenogenesis, and both of them invented their own version of a movable frame hive. Huber predates Zerzon by 30 years, maybe, something like that. But Zerzon says it's 19 days. And all the modern books say it's 21. Why is that? Well, because all the modern books were made from observing bees on foundation. And most of that's been enlarged for the last 100 and some years. So we've enlarged them, and that extends their gestation time. But Zerzon's observations and Huber's observations was that it was more like between 18 and 20 days. And typically it was 19, according to Zerzon. So I think it's significant for reasons that aren't obvious unless you understand the varroa life cycle.
Right.
If you understand the varroa life cycle, what happens is the varroa goes in the cell, and it's founder's mite, and now it gets capped. And she lays, somewhere in the first 32 hours or so, she lays a male egg. It's actually very similar to a bee, in the sense that the very first egg is haploid. That means it has a half of a set of genes. And anytime she lays a haploid egg, it becomes male. So it's the same way for a queen. If a queen bee lays an egg and it's not fertilized, it's haploid and it becomes a drone. And in this case, though, of course, it's becoming a male, just a male mite. But now you have this male mite, 32 hours later, a female gets laid, 32 hours later or so, a female gets laid, so on and so forth. So this goes on until it emerges. And meanwhile, those mites are maturing. And basically, she's in, let's say in a worker cell, she's going to lay about 10 eggs. One of them's a male, 9 of them are female, and only one or two of them will ever make it all the way to maturity and then mate with a male. Mm-hmm. That's, if you shorten the time by one day, then we go from 1.5 plus or minus a half mite, which is somewhere between 1 and 2, down to 0.5 plus or minus 0.5 mites by the time that make it to maturity, right?
Yeah.
We've reduced it by 1. So we've gone from an average of 1.5 to an average of a half. Mm. That's a huge decrease.
Yeah.
Now, the drones, we're probably only shortening it by a day, and the drones actually would get some more in there, because a small cell drone is still going to mature in about 22 to 23 days. So in 23 days, I'm going to get almost 2 more mites. But still, if I back it off by 1, I've gone from a possible 3 mites offspring to 2 mites offspring that make it to maturity. Any of those mites that don't make it all the way to maturity and don't get mated, they don't even live. When they emerge, they just die.
Mm, right.
So it's a huge difference in population if you shorten the post-capping time by 1 day. Now, if you reduce the pre-capping time by a day, which you do also, you've also made for less mites that go in the cell. So now you have less mites that go in the cell in the first place. So if you cut that in half, you've already cut the population in half. And then if you cut the ones that reproduce, how much they reproduce in half, now you've cut it down to less than a fourth of what they were accomplishing.
Yeah.
And there's also a study out there by Martin that says that if the cell size is smaller, there's a higher percentage of the males that get trapped outside the cocoon and don't manage to mate. And if they get trapped outside the cocoon and there's no male to mate with females, then none of them are viable. Now, how is this the only way that small cell helps? I don't know. It's hard to say what all of them things are. This is just some things that we actually have some research to show that, but we don't have.
Yeah.
You know, there's observations about them biting mites more and uncapping things more when they're small cell. Does making them small cell change their behavior? Certainly small cell people have observed some changes in their behavior. I don't know how much of that's because they're small cell. Often people who go small cell also start changing their genetics, because they always have a lot better luck with local surviving genetics. And
yeah,
that tends to change the behavior.
Yeah.
And that may be where some of the biting of mites and uncapping comes from. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, the reason why I asked kind of started with the, whether it was the cell size or something, more on the genetic side is, there was somebody, it may have been even D. Lesby, that had shortened the, I think, queen development time by, either several days or a couple days or something. And so I didn't know if, I'm assuming that was through, breeding, maybe queens that were, or bees that were able to shorten their development time by that much.
It would probably be wise of us to select bees for short gestation times. We're not doing that.
Yeah.
It would probably be wise. The Africanized queens are supposedly a shorter gestation time. I think it would be difficult though, as a queen rearer, I can tell you if the weather's really hot, I've seen them emerge 2 days early at the earliest, but often seen them emerge a day early. And in cool weather, I've seen them emerge 2 days late.
Mm.
So, we're talking about a 4-day range depending on the temperature outside and how,
Yeah, I've noticed that in my queens, or, you know, I really don't think it's the age of larva that I'm grafting. You know, I try to graft the youngest and smallest larva I can see, and it really seems like it's that they emerge, you know, right at day 15, I've even had it seem like they've emerged less, you know, even sometime on day 14. And so, there may have been only a few cases where they've actually emerged 16 days or later. So I don't know if that's my bees, if it's my grafting, you know, I'm not sure. I thought I was always curious.
Sometimes it's the weather.
Yeah. But
sometimes it's the genetics, I suppose. Just saying it's hard to select for something. It's hard to measure because it's so dependent on the ambient temperature, and the ambient temperature is so out of our control. So I'm not saying it couldn't be done, but it would get complicated trying to select for shorter gestation times for queens. Maybe queens would be the easiest thing to measure in order to do the selection. I don't know. But
yeah.
What we really want is shorter gestation times for the workers and the drones. But I think you get that just by going to smaller cells. But.
Yeah, that's another thing. You know, I'm wondering, what do you think is better? Just kind of regressing your bees naturally and having a natural cell size, or actually using the 4.9. Cell-sized plastic frames. Is there one that's better than the other?
Well, when I started, I'm a skeptic. So Dee's theory sounded logical, and it sounded good. I wasn't sure though if we weren't just making the mistake in the opposite direction. So I was thinking in terms of maybe I should see what they make on their own. So I kind of did both experiments at once. I put them on small cell and I did, tried to let them do whatever they want. And the end result I came to, though, was that just building what they want, it was often smaller than 4.9. So I don't think I'm trying to force them to a size that's smaller than what they would normally do. And sometimes it's easier and quicker to get them back to normal size by using foundation at first, at least, and then once you have them back down to normal size, use foundationless. And part of the reason for this regression idea is that once you get them larger, they tend to build cells based on their large, to build comb that's smaller than the large cell comb they grew up on, but not quite as small as what they would have done if they hadn't been enlarged. I always use the cubit illustration, when Noah was building the ark,
Yeah.
What's a cubit? Well, yeah. A cubit is distance from your elbow to the end of your finger, and I think that's pretty much how bees measure cells. They measure them by their own body. So
yeah, that makes sense.
An enlarged bee is probably going to build a slightly bigger cell than a normal-sized bee.
Yeah.
So getting over that hump is the regression idea. I need to get them back down to normal size, and once I do, then they'll probably build normal size cells. And when I let them build natural cells, they build a range of sizes. They aren't all the same size, and I think maybe that range of sizes serves some good purpose.
Yeah, we don't know what we don't know, and so if it's something that they've done for many thousands of years, it probably has some type of benefit, or it wouldn't have been that way till now.
Well, you could make the assumption that maybe it's just random chance that they happen to build different size cells, and then we happen to end up with different size bees. But if you look at all the other diversity that goes on in a colony, like how many drones the queen mated with, the more drones she mates with, the healthier the colony is. The more diverse the genetics of those drones, the more healthy the colony. And it does serve, we know that serves a purpose because people have done the research to measure that. So we know that when she mates with a lot of drones, we end up with more subfamilies of bees, and that actually makes transitions go smoother and feedback mechanisms go smoother. Because when it gets too hot, the bees from this one subfamily start spanning earlier than this other subfamily, and then the last ones to kick in are the first ones to quit, and then so there's more of a smooth transition from, oh, it's getting a little hotter, we need more ventilation, oh, it's getting even hotter, we need more ventilation, and oh, it's getting even hotter, we need even more ventilation, and that shift of gearing it up and turning it back down is partly runs smoother because of that diversity, that genetic diversity. Mm. So would size diversity play into things? I don't see any reason it wouldn't, but I don't know that of any evidence to prove that it does. But, you know, a small bee might be able to crawl down into a flower that a big bee can't crawl down into. And yeah, a big bee might have a long enough tongue to reach down into a little skinny flower that smaller bee can't reach down into the bottom of.
Yeah.
So,
or flight distance. You know,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was thinking, you know, maybe possibilities of flight distance, you know, if a larger bee is maybe sure. better at flying long, further distances than a smaller bee. Yeah, I don't know if that's sure. right, but that's just something that kind of I thought of.
And you might find that the bee that's better at the job takes that job on because they're better at it. You know, I don't know.
Mm, yeah.
It'd be interesting if somebody would do some research on that. But.
Yeah. What do you think are some of the, you know, most common mistakes with going small cell? Or, you know, you hear about some people that say they've tried it and it didn't work. You know, what do you think are the most common mistakes when people are trying to go small cell?
Well, I think beekeeping's complicated. Let's just leave all the small cell and treating and not treating and whatever out. Beekeeping's complicated. And in recent years, it's gotten tougher to keep bees alive. And anybody who pretends that they're not having any trouble keeping their bees alive by using all the given treatments, they're either just really lucky because of where they are or what genetics they got, or they're not really being honest with themselves. I'm not sure which. I hate to accuse people of being dishonest. And maybe they're not being dishonest. Maybe it's just conditions they find themselves in. And they'll make the same accusations against me. They'll say, well, maybe you're just in an area where you're just lucky. You know, maybe the genetics, the locale, the, you know, the presence of other beekeepers or whatever, maybe you're just lucky. But considering, you know, over the years I've bought some packages just to try and get more mating nukes going earlier, and I've, you know, been around other beekeepers, and I have yards scattered over, you know, a 120-mile radius, I really don't think that's likely. I don't think it's likely that I'm just isolated. There's people, there's other beekeepers out there, and I don't think I just got lucky and got a milder form of varroa mites, because I bought packages, and I'm sure they've got nasty mites in them.
Mm.
Now, do I think that we keep breeding meaner and stronger mites? Yeah, I think we are, and we shouldn't be doing that. But I think some of those accusations probably aren't true of my beekeeping, and they probably aren't true of other people's either. But that could be part of the reason why some people don't succeed at whatever their, you know, whatever their beekeeping philosophy is. But beekeeping in general is complicated. What I'm saying, I guess, is that success or failure, whether you're treating or you're not treating, has more to do with how good a beekeeper you are than it does whether you're treating or not treating properly. Although I think, all in all, treating is not the road to healthier bees. It's the road to contaminated comb and strong mites and wimpier bees. But still, you know, when somebody says they're succeeding or they're failing at something, it may be lack of experience or bad luck, or, you know, it's hard to say. It's harder to keep bees alive now than it's ever been. That's reality.
Yeah.
And
well, like we were talking about earlier, it's, you know, unless you're there actually looking at their hive, it's hard to know exactly what is going on or how to diagnose a certain problem.
See, I'm always torn. When you're on a forum and somebody's bees die, immediately 500 people tell them, might kill them. But you don't know that until you go look for evidence. And it's kind of foolish to jump to that conclusion, because they could have starved, they could There's all sorts of things that could have happened. Could it be mites? Certainly. That's one of the primary things that kills bees nowadays. But before I just jump to the conclusion, you should go over that. You know, get the bees okay, get this hollow bottom board. They scoop the beetle around a little and look underneath there. Do you see a lot of mites? You don't see hardly any mites? Well, then it probably wasn't the mites. But we can look more for mites. We can go look in the brood cells, and we can look for little white dots in the brood cells, which is varroa feces. If there's a lot of that, well, then they probably have a lot of varroa. So now the likelihood that it was mites is probably pretty high.
Yeah.
On the other hand, if I don't find any evidence of mite feces, and I don't find any evidence of dead mites on the bottom, well, then they probably died from something else. You know? And I think it's unfair to just assume that it's mites and assume that it's because you didn't treat, you know?
Yeah. When you get into that kind of routine of making assumptions, you kind of overlook other things, and then, you know, it's just, you know, maybe just a bad approach to assessing, you know, a specific problem. You know, I think we should take it maybe one problem at a time and listen to the details that the person is providing us before we make, you know, judgments or assumptions.
Of course, part of the problem, too, is that you're not there and you're not looking at them, and you might know really quickly if you're actually looking at them what you think it is, where if you can't see them and they're just describing it, you know, you don't know what they picked, what they thought was important to describe. You know, they may have skipped things that you would have noticed, and, you know, it's really hard to diagnose something third hand.
Do you think there's any benefit or any merit to trying to make progress in VSH behavior or bees that, you know, selectively remove reproductive mites or, you know, increase infertility in mites or any other types of behaviors like that? Or do you think that that is just kind of you know, maybe a useless, I'm not sure what the best word is, you know, way of going about using our resources? Or do you think it is just small cell is the best route?
I think genetics is involved in almost anything. I mean, I think, you know, I tried all this, though, before. I tried SMR bees, and I tried Russian bees, and I tried they were SMRs at the time, now they're VSHs. I tried Minnesota Hygienics, and I tried, you know, I actually had the buck fasts for decades, and they survived the tracheal mites, and I didn't even notice the tracheal mites. Yeah. But so that was a good thing, but they all died from varroa. Varroa didn't do any better or worse. The Russians seemed to survive a higher level of varroa before they died, but they didn't have any less varroa. But my problem with all those directions is that if you look at the history of selective breeding, as soon as you pick one trait and you start breeding for it, you will screw things up so badly it will be unrecoverable. And that's what scares me. I don't know that there's any evidence that VSH is going to help them survive. It's all based on mite counts. You know, we count mites, and we breed for VSH, and we compare the number of mites to the number of mites on some Italians, and therefore, because we counted less mites on this one, we assume this is better. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah.
For all I know, if let's take one of the theories. I've got small cell bees, and if the varroa mites recognize them as worker cells and drone cells and prefer the drones more than the workers at the same rate they do in Apis serrana, which is their natural host, then they wouldn't be doing any damage. But I might end up with four mites because they're actually more effective at reproducing in the drones. So if they were better at choosing drones all the time, they would reproduce better and do less harm to my bees. So counting mites may be a very misleading clue. Yeah. I'm going to count mites and assume because I have less mites that I'm better off, but maybe I'm not. maybe I'm better off with more mites, but the mites aren't doing damage to the workers. So I think you need to look at the big picture, and anytime you're focused on the cells and the leaves on the trees in the forest instead of looking at the forest, you're gonna do a bad job when you're breeding. We did it to every kind of cow and every kind of horse and every kind of dog. We screwed up so many good genetics on this planet by doing that, by picking this one or two or three or five things that we thought were important instead of looking at the big picture of, are they healthy? Are they long-lived? You know, in the case of horses, are they smart, healthy, and long-lived? And you know, they don't have health problems or whatever. But instead, we look at, do they have lots of feathers on their feet? And do they pick their feet up a long ways? And do they have a high neck set? And do they propel more from their back legs? And instead of looking at, are they, you know, willing and calm and gentle, and, you know, I just think we pick all the wrong things. We pick things that are superficial and irrelevant. Frankly, I think my counts are superficial and irrelevant. I know the scientists are convinced that that's the be-all, end-all of measurement, but that's because they insist on having a number. They have to have a number. If they don't have a number, they can't compare things. And I think you're better off to raise bees that are gentle and calm and don't need treatments. I don't care how many mites they have. I care if they survive. We can go back to the Russians.
Yeah.
I'm not big on the Russians, but the fact is they survived really high mite counts. If you were judging the Russians by nothing but mite counts that I had, then I would have judged them as pretty poor because they had all these mites. But actually, they survived longer than the other ones is how they got more mites, and they survived more mites. So the fact that they can survive more mites, I shouldn't hold that against them, I don't think. But they still succumbed to the varroa, so that didn't do me good. But I'm just saying, if I went by nothing but mite counts, I would have thrown out probably bees that have better resistance to the viruses.
Mm.
So I think if you look at the big picture, you're not going to make those mistakes. You're not going to throw out the one that's good at resisting viruses because you're looking for mite count, low mite counts. You're not going to throw out the one where they actually prefer the drones and reproduce better because you were trying to count mites instead of looking at what's actually happening in the pollen. Or just what's happening in the big picture. Are they healthy? Are they alive? Are they surviving? Are they...
Yeah. Yeah, there's a quote that Michael Palmer posts several times on BeeSource, and I think it was from David Tarpey that said that, you know, nature or man breeds by promoting the best or what they think is the best, and nature breeds by getting rid of the dogs, you know. It's almost as if getting rid of the susceptible hives is almost more important than promoting what we think is best, because, you know, when you identify what is a susceptible hive and requeen it or let it die, then you're a lot more broad in your selection, and you're probably going to be selecting for a variety of very beneficial traits than just one or two that we can identify, when there may be a bunch of other beneficial traits that we, you know, haven't discovered yet.
And see, I don't think we know the magic combination of traits that gives us gentle, productive, healthy, long-lived bees, because that's really what we need.
Yeah.
And if you pick any one of those things and you focus on just that, I think you'll screw it up. If you at least look at the big picture and say, I might be willing to compromise on some of those just for bees that will survive, but now that I have bees that will survive, I can select for, I want them to be gentle and productive and, you know, in the big picture. But, and I don't think that'll screw things up as long as I'm not focusing on the leaves on the trees in the forest. You know, I need to be just looking at the forest.
Yeah.
I need to be looking at the forest and saying, okay, I want the big picture. I want bees that are gentle and productive and healthy. If they're not gentle and productive and healthy, then none of them are. Well, then I've got nothing to breed from. But if I've got healthy, productive, gentle bees that are surviving, well, then out of that gene pool, I can keep picking healthy, productive, gentle bees that are surviving. You know, if some of them are mean, I can call those out. If some of them are not productive, I can not breed from those. I tend to take the view that I don't necessarily want to call those out. I just won't necessarily want to raise a whole bunch of queens off of them.
Yeah.
I've got this hive that's surviving and it's not that productive. Well, that's okay. I don't care. It's still surviving. I'm probably not going to raise any queens off of it, but it's still contributing to the broader gene pool, and I'm not going to hold that against them if they're doing okay. If they're costing me a lot of money and effort and food, then from my point of view, they're not really surviving. I'm having to coddle them, and I don't, you know, I might just let them die. But I don't know. I just think we need to look at the whole picture, and I don't think that's what any of these people are doing, because they want to be so scientific and they want to measure everything. And that's how we got where we are. They measured exactly how solid the brood patterns were, and in the process they bred against hygienic behavior, because that's the only way to get a solid brood pattern. You have to breed against them ever removing any brood. You know? So we bred against hygienic behavior for 100 years or more. We bred against them propolizing, which now Marlis Vivek has pretty much proven has been to their detriment, because the more propolis they make, the better their health is. And we bred them to not make any. We bred them to not make any for 150 years. And they pretty much don't make any. I mean, the word propolis itself means before the city. It got its name from people observing a colony of bees, and there's always all of this propolis out in front of the entrance, because they would adjust the size of the entrance with propolis. But how many modern Italian domestic bees do that? I've never seen one do that. I've seen the Carniolans do it, and I've seen the wild bees do it, but the Italians don't do that anymore. We bred that out of them.
Yeah. Or, you know, even to this day, some people still are breeding for certain colors, which, you know, that amazes me that we go by what they look like as far as what we think is best for their survival, their color.
Yeah. That's probably the least important thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, I've only been keeping bees for since 2011. I mean, what do you think is the future of beekeeping? Are you optimistic? Does it seem like it's getting better as far as bees being able to survive, or beekeepers getting better? You know, what's your outlook?
There's a lot more people not treating them and keeping them alive now than there were 10 years ago. So I'd say in that sense it's gotten better. I go speak at beekeeping meetings all the time, and I've been doing that since the early 2000s. And back then, when I would talk about not treating, I would almost always get at least one person who was just, you know, angry that I would dare say such a thing. And now I don't get that kind of reaction at all. There may be somebody there who doesn't quite agree with me, but for the most part, most of the people came to hear me speak because that's what they want to do. They want to not treat them. So I think that attitude has changed quite a bit. Unfortunately, the attitude of the scientists doesn't seem to have changed that much in that respect. I was at an Ohio meeting, and it was the Ohio State meeting a couple of years ago. They had a panel, and you know, it was all the speakers in the panel, and some of them were, well, there was me who was treatment-free, and there was a judge who was treatment-free and has been for quite a while, and there was a couple of professors from the colleges who were bee scientists there, and there was a couple of people from like other pollinators, Xerxes Society, I don't know what all, more organically minded people. And so they asked the panel where they thought the future of beekeeping would evolve. And bee scientist immediately pops up, well, you know, I think we're going to genetically engineer bees. You're going to be able to walk in and tell and exactly what you need a bee to pollinate, or the honey, or going to be that, you know, survives really cold winters because you live in a really bad, you know, bad winter kind of a climate, and they will just give you the bee that's been engineered for exactly what it is you want. And yeah, it's the audience is kind of like in this stunned silence, you know.
Yeah.
And so then they're asking, are anybody else on the panel? And I said, yeah, I don't think that's the direction people want to go at all. I talk to beekeepers all the time. I don't know any beekeepers who want to go that direction. No. I don't know any beekeeper right now who's in favor of genetically engineering bees.
Yeah, no. I don't see how that, you know, if the past is any indication of the future, I don't know how that would be the best route to go at all.
Exactly. So somebody from the audience basically then piped up and said, you know, I buy organic food. I buy non-GMO food. I buy, you know, I got into bees because that's my view of the world is I want, you know, I want organic food. I want organic things. And you're talking about my worst nightmare.
Yeah. That sounds pretty scary. I'm thinking of artificially intelligent nano bees that are going to take over the world. I don't know.
So then one of the guys on the panel who's actually representing one of the companies making, you know, Varroa treatments, he says, you know, if we don't treat them, they're all going to die. And the judge sitting next to me says, excuse me, he says, I've been keeping bees without treating them for 15 years. Michael here's been keeping bees without treating them for at least that long, and our bees haven't died. So how can you even dare to say that?
Yeah.
but people say that all the time. I don't know.
Yeah. Oh man. Well, I've got a couple questions from somebody. If you don't care to answer, and then I'll let you go. Let me bring those up. Pros and cons of a screen bottom board.
Well, especially if you're going to do any kind of treatment, you probably ought to have one just so you can see how effective the treatment was. You could count mites before, count mites during, and you can count mites after really well. The other advantage, if you're going to treat, I'm not recommending treating, I'm just saying it's one of the advantages of a screen bottom board. If you're going to treat, you also have the advantage that a lot of them that might have been injured but might have survived and then might have passed on the ability to survive the mite treatments fall to the bottom board and die and stiff. Or if it was a solid bottom board, they might crawl back up, get back on a bee and survive. That's probably an advantage. Some people just love all that extra ventilation. I thought that was a good idea too. I bought a bunch of screen bottom boards, but the more I would try to create more ventilation because they were bearding on the outside, the more I started to question whether I was actually helping them or creating more work. Because just because I get them to all go inside doesn't mean I fixed something. It may mean I broke something and they had to go inside to fix it. You know, they've got to cool the hive by evaporating water. And if I suddenly open the bottom wide open and create some ventilation on the top, and now there's this chimney effect going on, I may have just made their life much more difficult, not easier. Just because I got them all to go inside, I just don't think that proves that I'm helping. So I'm not necessarily against screen bottom boards. About half my bottom boards are screened, and I'm not throwing them away. But I don't buy them anymore. I buy solid ones anymore because they're the same price and they last longer. And I get to use them as a feeder if I need a feeder. You can just tip them backwards. Actually, just prop up the front a little bit, you can pour syrup in there and use them as a feeder. So you have other options with a solid bottom board I don't have with a screen bottom board. But the screen bottom board's easier if you're going to monitor mites. I don't monitor mites anymore, so I don't really care. But if you're going to try and count mites, it's a nice way to monitor your mite levels. Because you can kind of keep an eye on them all the time without really messing with them. You just pull the tray out, count mites, clean it off, put it back in, and you have an idea kind of what's going on in the colony without opening it up.
I have nothing
against screen bottom boards as long as you're not leaving them wide open. Because wide open in the summer makes it hard for them to cool it, and wide open in the winter makes it hard for them to heat it. And I don't think you ought to leave them wide open. I think you should leave the tray in.
What are the signs to look for during an inspection that signal the need to feed?
Well, main thing is, I mean, the main thing is capped honey, but then, and that also is going to depend on the time of year and what else is going on. I mean, obviously, if there's nectar coming in and they're gaining weight, I don't need to feed them. I guess that's obvious to me. Apparently, it's not obvious to everybody because I meet people all the time who just feed all the time. You need to have a reason to be feeding them, and you need to realize that there is a downside to feeding. I hear often people saying that it doesn't hurt to feed them, but it does hurt to feed them. One of the downsides is it often sets off robbing. Another downside is it kind of upsets the whole pH of the colony and has an effect on the microorganisms that live in their stomach. And there's quite a bit of recent research on that matter, and then there's quite a bit all the way back to the 80s on that matter. But it disrupts the microbes in their gut when you feed them syrup. And those microbes create a biofilm that protects them from things like Nosema and AFB and EFB. And so feeding them syrup makes them more susceptible to all those things. And we've got research to back all that up. So I don't know why people are always saying it doesn't hurt to feed them. But on the other hand, yes, if they're out of food and they're already out of food, and there's not food, you know, a flow going on where they can bring in food, well, then obviously you need to feed them or they're going to starve. Now, going into winter, different matter. In the middle of summer, I'm just trying to get them through till something blooms again. But in the winter, I've got to get them through the whole winter, so they need to come into winter with enough food to get through the winter. They also need a last batch of young brood before they go into winter.
Yeah.
And most years I don't have to do anything about that because most years I get a fall flow and there's plenty of pollen and there's plenty of nectar and they get a nice batch of brood going in winter. But some years I have a dearth that runs all the way into fall and the fall flow fails. If I don't feed them, then I don't get that last batch of young brood, especially if I don't feed them pollen. Or if they're light, they just don't have enough food to get through the winter and I don't something, then you're going to starve. So my criteria in the fall is a little different than my criteria in the summer or early spring. It kind of depends on what's going on around them as well as what's going on in the colony. But if there's no cap honey in the colony, they probably need to be fed.
Yeah.
Because there should be. That's their stores. That's what's going to get them through a rainy days, you know, a whole week of rainy days. So.
Yeah, I think that's a good answer. All right, I got one more. How do you clean frames of comb after a dead out? And they said that they flame the hive bodies, but the comb is another thing. Some people dip them in bleach. I'm thinking of spraying them with vodka and air drying.
Just give them back to the bees. As long as I'm pretty sure there's no AFB, I just give them back to the bees. They'll clean it up. Whatever's wrong with them, they'll clean it up.
Yeah.
If they're moldy, they'll clean it up. If they're fermented, they'll clean it up. If they're...
Yeah, I've actually, for one of the queen operations I worked for, in order to get rid of that old, unused larva in the grafting frames, we would set the frame back probably 15 feet and... As long as it was a dark comb, you could take a sprayer on a hose and spray out the larva and the pollen and stuff. So I would assume that that would clean off mold or whatnot. If you're gently spraying it with a hose would probably work too, I would think.
If it's full of wax moths, I'd probably scrap it.
Yeah.
It's just got like one web running through it. I might just leave it and let the bees fix it. But
oh yeah.
But other than that, I'm just gonna give it back to the bees. I don't. And unless it's like one that reeks of mice, because the mice made a nest in there and peed all over it. Then I'd probably stick it out in a box out in the rain for a month, and then after it's aired out and washed, gotten rained on enough times, I might put it back in my hive again. But.
All right.
But that's about the only ones I think are too nasty to put back in. They're all covered in mouse pee.
All right, well, I'm going to let you go. I know you're a busy guy and you've got some talks coming up, so you'll probably want to get a good night's rest before you travel. Yeah, thanks again for taking the time to do this. I thought you covered a lot of good stuff, and so I think people will be really interested in hearing this. So yeah, have a safe trip to Alaska, and I hope that conference goes well, and good luck.
Thanks.
So that was my talk with Michael Bush. Be sure to check out his website at bushfarms.com/bees. He also posts a lot on BeeSource and BeeMaster. And he also has a book, The Practical Beekeeper, which is a kind of compilation of his website. And you can find Huber's New Observations, the book that we were discussing. And again, check out the Thinking Bee Podcast group page on Facebook. And you can check out my business page, Ratcliffe Beekeeping, for updates in my own apiary and bees and queens for sale and classes that I offer. And until next time, thanks for listening.